Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh, Sri Parag Patel, colleagues, and my young friends. It is indeed a great privilege for us to have in our midst Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh, a doyen from India in the academic movement. Let me say that I know that you are all here to listen to him and not to me, so I will take the liberty of being very brief in my introduction, and I take that same liberty from you, sir, to be very brief in my introduction, because you are such a well-known personality that everybody knows about you already, and there's not much more that I would be able to add at this juncture. But first, let me say just a few words about the lecture series, An Ailing Indian Polity, Perspectives and Actions. You must be wondering why we have chosen this theme, and a little bit more on what we propose to do in terms of inviting other speakers to speak on this theme. But why this theme is certainly an issue that we are all very much interested in knowing about. All well-meaning people with the capacity and ability to think have been quite amazed by what has been happening in the last few years in our governance at the central level and in many of the states. We have for years been talking about the fact that ours is the largest democracy in the world, and we became a democracy, a functioning democracy, much before many other countries. And given the size of our country, the population of our country, the diversity in our country, the multi-ethnicity in our country, it has indeed been a great challenge to make it a functional democracy. And as we have gone on in time, we obviously have done some very good things. We also have done some things which have not turned out to be so good for us in terms of our governance. But above all, what has intrigued me the most over the years is the fact that somehow we have perhaps inherited some wrong traditions also from the British. The British, with its monarchy, talked about rulers. So they ruled India when they were in India, and they ruled over so many other countries of this world. And indeed, it was said that the sun never sets over the British Empire. And when India became free, it was the beginning of the setting of the sun in some ways. But the British ruled, and we thought that by becoming a good functional democracy, we would move, change, shift from ruling to governing. But interestingly enough, we did not change in that sense at all, because to this day, everybody talks about the ruling party. Everybody talks about who's going to rule over India. Everybody talks about who's going to rule over a particular state. And this is something I have always felt, even from my younger years, something that is not very appropriate in a democracy, where we should be talking about governance and rather than rulership. Perhaps one monarchy has been replaced by another in some parts of our country or in the country at large. And it's really quite an interesting and serious issue. And over the years, particularly the last several years, there has been creeping in a sense of despondency amongst many about where the country is headed because of the kinds of issues that have cropped up, with which we are trying to grapple, and the manner in which they are being addressed by many of our institutions and those who govern the country. And we thought that it is indeed appropriate that as an academic institution, we should reflect on these issues. We should think about what has really gone wrong, if at all we believe that something has gone wrong. And finally, how do we bring about the change that we need? So we thought about inviting eminent people to talk to us on this subject, who have written on this, who are aware of history, and indeed have tried to engineer significant change in our polity so that we define a different and perhaps a better path for ourselves. I have great pleasure in just saying a few words in trying to introduce Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh. As you all know, he was educated at the universities of Bombay and London. He is a fellow of the Royal Society of Arts and the Academy of the Learned Societies for Social Sciences, and a professor of political philosophy at the University of Westminster. Lord Parekh was chair of the Runnymede Commission on the Future of Multi-Ethnic Britain during the period 1998 to 2000. And indeed, that path-breaking report is always referred to as the Parekh Report. The Future of Multi-Ethnic Britain was published in 2000. He is vice chairman of the Gandhi Foundation, a trustee of the Anne Frank Educational Trust, and a member of the National Commission on Equal Opportunity. Of course, he is presently also a member of the Prime Minister's Advisory Council, and he has also been the Vice Chancellor of the MS University at Baroda. Had a brief stint there. His main academic interests include political philosophy, the history of political thought, social theory, ancient and modern Indian political thought, and the philosophy of ethnic relations. He is the author of Rethinking Multiculturalism, Cultural Diversity and Political Theory, Gandhi, Colonialism, Tradition and Reform, Gandhi's Political Philosophy, Contemporary Political Thinkers, Karl Marx's Theory of Ideology, and Hannah Arendt and the Search of a New Political Philosophy. These are all his books that have been published during different years. Lord Parekh has received many awards through his career. The Sir Isaiah Berlin Prize for Lifetime Contribution to Political Philosophy by the Political Studies Association in 2002. The Distinguished Global Thinker Award by the India International Center, Delhi in 2006. The Interdependence Prize from the Campaign for Democracy, New York, 2006. And the Padma Bhushan Honors in 2007 from the Government of India. The list is still very long, and as I said, I will take the liberty of being brief, so I will not say more and not come between you and our speaker for the day on this very important theme. But before I request Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh to begin his address, we would like to welcome him with a bouquet of flowers, and I request Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh to accept this little token from us as a word of welcome. I'm sure he's going to address us in English today. On Saturday, when I went to listen to him, he had a little bit of a dilemma whether it's going to be Gujarati or English. But today, I'm sure he will be speaking to all of us in English so that we are all very comfortable listening to him and enjoying his lecture. He has kindly agreed to answer some questions at the end of his talk, and depending upon the interest, we will continue for that many minutes. Once again, a very warm, hearty, and welcome to Lord Bhikkhubhai Parekh. We're very grateful to you, sir, for having accepted our invitation. Thank you.
Caldera and students and distinguished guests. First of all, let me begin by saying how pleased and privileged I am to be able to come here, my first visit to this university, and to thank the organizers for not only a very kind introduction by Dr. Caldera, but also giving me some idea of the history and development of this university. The subject is, as you can see, an ailing Indian polity, which is a medical metaphor. And my assignment is to threefold. Are we ailing or is it a mistake? If we are ailing, what is the ailment? Is it cardiac failure? Is it heart attack? Or is it cancer, which is slowly eating away? And thirdly, pretending for a minute to be a doctor or a physician, what is my prescription? And how costly is that prescription? So these are the three things I'm going to do in the next 45 odd minutes that I have. Let's start with what Dr. Caldera was saying. India is the largest democracy. I have some difficulty with both these expressions, the largest and also the word democracy. When we say we are the largest, do we mean anything more than our people multiply faster than they do anywhere else? I mean, we are over 3.5 billion people. Is this what we are proud of? What makes us the largest, other than the simple numerical fact of how many we are? And I want to argue, as I will explain in a minute, that the largest refers not merely or not particularly to the number of people who inhabit this wonderful country, but also to the way in which we have conducted elections and tried to retain a deliberative form of democracy in a particular kind of way. And the second word in what Dr. Caldera said is democracy. And as I was saying in another meeting a little earlier, we were not meant to be just a democracy. If you look at the Constitution of India, it describes us as a democratic republic. In other words, we were meant to be a republic. And the word democracy is used, this is for the benefit of those of you who are interested, not as a noun, but as an adjective. We are not a republican democracy, where the word republic would adjectivize or qualify us as a democracy. The substance is republic, and democracy is meant to qualify that republic, to adjectivize that republic. And it's also very striking that the word democracy was not used in the objectives resolution, which was proposed by Panditji, by which I mean Pandit Nehru, in 1946. The resolution said, India shall be a sovereign republic. And when he was asked why the word democracy was excluded, he said, it is included in the word republic. In which case, why not use democracy? And he said, because republic means far more than democracy. A few weeks later, in the first draft of the Constitution, the word democracy was used and the word republic was dropped. And in the final draft, as we always tend to do, the two were combined and we became a democratic republic. Now, I don't have the time because I want to go on to do other things. And since not all of you are students of philosophy or political philosophy, I think it will be inappropriate for me to take you through the history of the idea of republic in our tradition. What did republic mean and when does the idea first appear in our tradition? But the point is that India was supposed to be a democratic republic and not just a democracy. And it's also striking that we are the only country who celebrates 2 days, the Independence Day, 15th of August, and the Republic Day. Now, if democracy is the same as a republic, why do we celebrate 2 days? And the only country in the world to do that. Why? And not only do we celebrate 2 days, but we celebrate them totally differently. On 15th of August, which belongs to the government, the ruler, as you rightly put it, the Prime Minister appears 50 feet high, Lal Killa, in a bulletproof enclosure, lectures to the carefully selected audience, and goes away. Republic Day is very different. It belongs to the people of India. The President, not the Prime Minister, takes the salute, because the Prime Minister represents a party, the President represents the country. And you have various floats and parades representing the diversity of India, and people from all walks of life. I remember when I was a Vice Chancellor, I don't know, Prafulla, if you have been there, but in my days when I was a Vice Chancellor between 1981 and 84, I was regularly invited every year to attend, and there was an enclosure for what is called eminent educationists. Whether I was eminent or whether I was an educationist, I wasn't sure, but I was sure that I was a Vice Chancellor. So it belonged to the people. Now look at the difference between, and also also, the state honors, whether you get Padma Shri or Padma Bhushan or whatever, are announced on the Republic Day, not on the Independence Day. And I wonder if any of you has ever asked yourself, why? Why this difference between 2 days? How did the difference appear? And those who created the difference, what were their motives? What were their intentions? Now, having raised that question, like a good university professor, I'm going to leave it at that, so that you can think and you can consult the library and try to find yourself rather than be spoon-fed by me. But what I do want to say is that India was supposed to be, in the eyes of the founding fathers and mothers and uncles and aunts of our republic, was supposed to be a democratic republic, more importantly a republic. And we have foolishly, ignorantly truncated it to a democracy. And that is the first tragedy of India, that we have forgotten the republican part. And having reduced ourselves to a democracy, we took the next step, where democracy had come to be equated with the largest democracy. And largest means in terms of election, full stop. So the whole essence of democracy is reduced to elections. And we take pride in the fact that we hold elections regularly, systematically, fairly, and all that. It is all that we are proud of. What I want to do is to question that reduction. The reduction of the republic to a democracy, and the second reduction of democracy to election, as if there is nothing more to democracy than election. So this is the direction in which I want to go. What have we gained and what have we lost by this double abstraction or double reduction? And I want to argue that it is this double reduction which explains the ailing polity. So let's start. Now, democracy has been the basis of our national existence since 1947, or if you like, since 1952, because the first elections took place in 1952. Independence is something that is given to us by the British. And here I plead guilty because I am 3/4 of British, for the simple reason that I have spent more years in Britain than here, but I claim no responsibility for what the British did to India. And although I sit in the British House of Lords, I remember when I was first appointed to the British House of Lords, in my inaugural speech in the House of Lords, I said the following, that as I rise to speak, I'm haunted by the ghosts of those viceroys and those governor generals who ruled over my country, some wisely, some unwisely. As an Indian, I couldn't resist standing there and looking at those seats where Lord Clive, Marquis of Salisbury, Mountbatten, who made a complete mess of our country and resulted in this enormous bloodshed, I couldn't resist looking at the seats where they used to sit, making sure that I never occupy those seats myself. So independence is something given to us by outsiders. Of course, they fought and they had no choice. Republic is something we give to ourselves. That's why the Constitution says, we the people of India, having resolved, and we give ourselves this Constitution. So Republic is our gift to ourselves. Democracy is the British gift to us. And I want to, although I would have loved to talk about the Republican tradition, we'll come to that in a minute, I want to talk about democracy. It has been a part of our life since 1947 or 1952. And I think we have kept it going, and that's a remarkable achievement. And there are lots of pluses that democracy has achieved. It has given dignity to everybody. Whoever you are, you have a right to vote. You stand in this, a Dalit stands in the same queue as a Brahmin. They rub shoulders, which would be unthinkable anywhere else. They go and vote in the same box. And the box has a certain ritual, religious character about it. It's silence, you press the button and a miracle happens, as it happened in Delhi recently in the elections. That button has a magic power to achieve all kinds of things. Your fingers are marked by black ink in the same way that you will carry tilak on your forehead in a temple. So the election has acquired this norm, given a lot of dignity and a sense of power to our people. It has generated a spirit of equality, that irrespective of your caste, especially in a hierarchical society like ours, it has been a very revolutionary, radical force. It has brought in those groups which were excluded for a long time and which had no share in the running of the country. It has generated an awareness of rights, that individuals are not simply supplicants, but they are entitled to certain claims and these claims must be met. And it has, of course, resulted in all kinds of programs which benefit people. So democracy has a lot to be thankful. We have a lot to be thankful for institutionalizing democracy and achieving all this. So the tangible and intangible gains of democracy are beyond doubt. But the way in which we have practiced democracy has also had its profound limitations or drawbacks. And I want to divide this into four major categories. See, democracy involves elections. So let's look at the kinds of elections that we have in this country. Democracy involves discussion, or what I might call deliberation. And we'll look at the quality of deliberation that takes place in our parliament, in the media, and elsewhere. Democracy involves observing certain public norms, public morality. And let us ask ourselves, has our democracy lived up to certain norms? Does it respect public norms? Does it respect public morality? And finally, democracy is supposed to achieve, satisfy the basic needs of our people. And the fourth question to ask is, has our democracy succeeded in promoting the welfare of ordinary people? And if not, why not? So these are the four questions I want to ask, or four areas I want to look at. The quality of our elections, the quality of our public deliberation, the moral character of our public life, and the results of democracy in terms of the lives of aam aadmi or aam aurat or ordinary people. Let's start with elections. Now obviously our elections are free and fair, but I would not say that they are equal or they provide equal playing fields. I think we must be one of the few democracies where far more people inherit their position than they fight for it. You must have seen figures which I think were produced by a scholar who said that in the current parliament, 70% of the women are there because their relations, father, mother, husband or uncle, were in parliament. If you look at people and MPs under 40, 68% come from families with political connections. And one of their relations was a member of parliament. And if you look at people under 30, all of them have fathers or mothers who are MPs and their children. Now that's an extremely disturbing factor, partly because the further you go down the age range, the greater the number. In other words, the number of people who benefit by virtue of their dynastic connection is not limited to Rahul Gandhi or Priyanka Gandhi. The dynastic principle permeates every area of our life and almost all major political parties, with the exception, I don't want to give a false impression, with the exception of the communists and the BJP. Strange combination, but if you look at the Congress, Samajwadi Party, the so-called Samajwadi Party, which is really a casteist party, these parties where the dynastic connection is extremely important. It is also the case that if you look at the quality of candidates who present themselves for election, they come more or less from in the same mold, same political class, the same culture, the same habits, the same kind of education. no hinterland. Hardly any of them has a grassroots experience of working among the people and building up a support base which would help them to win election. They are entirely dependent on politics. They are created by politics, of politics, for politics. It is also, I think, very striking that huge sums of money are involved in every election. A candidate standing for parliament would require nothing less than 5 to 6 crores. And of course, this rules out a large number of poor people, candidates, who simply don't have that kind of money. Most candidates don't have that kind of money, so where do they get them from? From political parties. And where do political parties get their money from? Well, you know, I don't have to tell you. I mean, either through donations or through contracts, or when in government you make sure that the rich business corporate houses fund you appropriately. I think it's very striking that an average MP, his assets of an average MP amount to 5.6 crores. An average MP. And it's also striking that in current Lok Sabha, 306 MPs are millionaires in dollar terms. Now, if we mean by elections being free and fair, then obviously they are not free and fair because a large number of people are excluded. There is also the case that in our parliament, there has been a close association not only between business and politics, but also between criminals and politics. In the current parliament, 152 members of parliament have been charged, not all indicted, but charged with one kind of serious crime or another. But this is at the national level. If you look at the state level, the factors are far more disturbing. In Bihar, last election under Nitish Kumar's second term of office, 110 out of 240 members of the Legislative Assembly have been charged, some indicted, for criminal offences. In the UP, 35% of the MLAs have been charged with criminal offences involving violence, rape, all sorts of things. Now, this puzzling thing in India is why people vote for criminals. If you know that somebody has a criminal record, why do people vote? At one level is puzzling, at another level the answer is simple. And the simple answer is, and this is what some surveys have shown, A, many of these criminals have some kind of track record of doing something for people. A clean man parachuted from outside, he may be clean, but he has done nothing for the people. He hasn't built up a network of support. And also with a criminal, he understands the system, so you can count on him getting your work done. Because he's a thug himself, and therefore he will know how to recognize other thugs and get things out of them. And a voter at the end of the day wants to get things done. So for all these reasons, I would say that our election procedure, although basically democratic, suffers from serious flaws. The pool of talents that is available is limited because of the dynastic principle, because of the limitations imposed by money, because of the criminalization. For all these reasons, the number of honest people who get into parliament is extremely limited. And I think there is also the further problem that as between different political parties, if I was a candidate and if I was a voter and I had to choose, what is the variety of political options or ideological options? There are many political choices that I would have liked to make. There is no liberal party, properly so-called. There is no Swatantra Party was one, but that's gone. There is no socialist party, if I'm looking for one, because these so-called socialist parties from UP and Bihar are all basically casteist. If I'm looking for a genuine left outside the communist, There is no political party I would dream of voting for because there is none on offer. So the range of political space has shrunk so dramatically that the voter's choice is reduced to, and I'll talk about Aam Aadmi Party in a minute, reduced to one between BJP and Congress, or the regional parties. And sometimes I've asked myself, what is the difference between BJP and Congress? And we are told one is secular, the other is not secular. But then what does secular mean in there? How secular is Congress? And if you look at the way in which it has behaved over the years, I wouldn't say it was particularly secular. But equally importantly, the whole debate is bogus debate. Because the Constitution of India would not allow a non-secular party to be ever in power. The Constitution says clearly that the state shall not privilege or identify itself with any particular religion. Therefore, by definition, a party which is not secular cannot come to power because it would be challenged in the Supreme Court. So the Constitution rules out all those things, so the difference between BJP and Congress can't be that one is secular, the other is not. The only difference is one is secular, the other is pseudo-secular, whatever that may mean. But what does pseudo-secular mean? I'm lost. And if you look at the Constitution, there is a systematic assumption in the Constitution, very Gandhian, and at some level slightly dangerous, where it is assumed that the Hindus are in power, minorities feel threatened by them, and therefore Hindus are to be an elder brother, generous. So the kind of secularism that we have is protective secularism, where the state can interfere with social practices of all communities, but we will protect certain minorities and we will not interfere. That is built into the Constitution. So the pseudo-secular bit doesn't come to very much. So what is the difference? Tweedledum and Tweedledee. And at the end of the day, therefore, the entire electoral procedure boils down to these two parties between which the differences are, at the end of the day, very minor and not terribly significant and artificially inflated. So that's the first point I wanted to make about the quality of election. Let us look at the second. Democracy is about rational discussion. And Amartya Sen is absolutely right. When following John Rawls, he says, democracy is institutionalized public reason. I have debated this with him on many occasions when I was a professor at Harvard, or even subsequently. What does public reason mean? But we will not go into all this. Democracy is not just majority deciding something. It's talking, discussing, disagreeing, raising objections. Democracy is about deliberation. Well, what about the quality of our deliberation? Parliament from 1952 onwards, or if you like 1947 onward, used to meet on average for 124 days. Today is 55. And if a session is wiped out because of disruption, it can be even less than 40. Scores of legislation to be passed, with all the interruptions that take place in 55 days, you can imagine what happens. But that's at the parliament, which is visible. What about the assemblies? Extremely depressing. In Maharashtra, the state legislature meets on average during the last 10 years for 42 days. In Gujarat, 31 days. In Haryana, well, 14. And in Arunachal, 8. They meet 8 days in these MLAs whom we elect. They meet 8 days in a year and get rid of about 150 pieces of legislation. Now, what kind of deliberation do you expect taking place there? But that's not the end of the story. You see, when a bill is introduced, and I can say something about, you were giving the example of Great Britain. In Britain, I sit in Parliament, although we use the word Parliament differently, because I'm not a member of Parliament, because Parliament refers to House of Commons, House of Lords is different, but still it's part of Parliament. We meet on average for about 134, 135 days. A bill is introduced, first reading, second reading, where there's a day-long debate. Then it goes into committee where clause by clause by clause, it is examined by lawyers and experts, evidence is taken. Then it comes up at the report stage, discussion, third reading, and finally it is passed. No bill passes in less than about a week to a fortnight. Sometimes it takes weeks. What happens with us? Our great parliament passed last year 22 pieces of legislation in 18 minutes. I thought, why did it take 18? It could have, the damn thing could have been done in 2 minutes. But we are concentrating on parliament, but the picture is rosy. I just couldn't believe this when I read that in Bihar, 96% of the bill were passed on the same day that they were introduced. The bill is presented, half an hour later, second reading, 5 minutes in the committee stage, half an hour later, the third reading, pass. The bill has not been carefully scrutinized. But you say, look, it is to be expected in Bihar. What about the politically sophisticated state like West Bengal? 91% of the bill in West Bengal last year were passed on the same day. And if you look at Haryana, during last 10 years, no debate of any kind has taken place on any piece of legislation. Very often these bills are sent to committee in parliament. I won't bore you with the legislative details, but these bills go through various standing committees, departmental committees and all that. But many of these committees are completely at the mercy of the chairman. And the chairman is usually somebody who works very closely with the government. And the committees might conduct a superficial scrutiny. Now, there have been great committees like Public Administration, Public Accounts Committee. After careful scrutiny and collecting evidence, they present reports. But do you know, the government is not required to accept those recommendations. You can reject all recommendations, and more importantly, you don't have to give reasons for rejecting those recommendations. This would be unthinkable in all parliaments in the Western world, unthinkable in the United States, unthinkable in the country where I live and work. Well, all right, the parliament behaves badly. What about the newspapers? What about the media? Their job is to scrutinize these bills and examine them closely. The newspapers, the television, the radio. Well, I don't want to take the risk of alienating the press, but I must say that the press, apart from odd newspapers here and there, leaves a great deal to be desired. Many of them would pick up news from the internet. They don't have the money to keep correspondents abroad. They rely on press releases by embassy or the government. Occasionally they would investigate, but investigate a corruption or a scandal, not investigate a serious issue. I haven't seen a serious issue being investigated. And on television, it's all about entertainment. And I remember asking a friend of mine once, and that helped me understand why this happens in India. It happens everywhere. I mean, after all, we do want to be entertained at the end of the day. But why this tends to happen in India? And I remember asking a question to one of the greatest film directors, Lord Putnam, very dear friend of mine, sits with me in the House of Lords. And David produced two, many great films. He is a Hollywood director. He produced a great film called The Chariots of Fire, and the second one is called The Killing Fields of Vietnam. David loves India. He adopted a leper's daughter from India and raised her. And I said to David, look, these Bollywood films, I find it unbearable, most 99.9% of them. Why haven't they made a breakthrough? Indians are entertained by them, but the whites are bored. They find them childish, infantile. why haven't we crossed the cultural barrier? The Bollywood films. And he's a very wise man. He said he loves India, he works closely with Indian film directors, and he summed up in one sentence. He said, in the West, cinema is a form of art. In India, cinema is a form of entertainment. He said, that is the greatest tragedy of Indian cinema and of Bollywood. I said, explain to me, because I am not a student of art. He said, the job of the art is to destabilize you, to give you a new pair of eyes, to change you. You see a beautiful picture and you go away saying, oh my God, I'm haunted by this. The job of the entertainment is to keep you quiet, not to disturb you at all, to reinforce your prejudices. So that for a few minutes, you laugh and then you go away as if nothing has happened. An artist never leaves you alone, like a great novel. He haunts you, because he has put something in his head. Entertainment does the opposite. And he said, this is why, as long as in India, apart from Satyajit Ray and one or two other people, as long as in India, cinema continues to be seen as a form of... He said, this is how it came to India, history. And this is how it developed in the West, historically. I think that our television, the way the television entered our public life, what we expect of a television, when we watch television, how do we watch television, in between two programs, a housewife cooking and then feeding, and in between watching TV, a serial, with the result that we expect television to entertain, and therefore when serious matters come, we also expect them to entertain. And they entertain by fighting, punch-up, shouting, all sorts of things. Where the anchor man is not doing no anchor, I mean, he's part of the fight. Now with that kind of thing, apart from a few brave and courageous programs where debates do take place, there is hardly public deliberation taking place on TV. And newspapers have increasingly seemed to have, certainly in my view, many of them have seemed to have lost a sense of direction. Partly because they depend on advertisement, which comes from big business. And the link between the owners of newspapers and television companies is incredibly striking. Dainik Bhaskar, for example, owns 69 companies. And these companies deal in minerals, power and real estate. Now, would you expect a newspaper whose owner also owns mines and real estate to report the scandals of those mines or to discuss them intelligently? Then again, your profits depend on the circulation. Circulation depends on how many people read. Now, if you are an English language paper, you depend on young students with their half illiterate command of English. You expect them, now they are not going to read serious articles. Nearly 50 to 60% of a newspaper's readership consists of young people between 18 to 35, many of them students. Now students, you know what happens in our colleges, this may be an exception, but by and large, poorly educated poor chaps, not much command of English, not interested in serious issues. They have their own homework to do, they are struggling for survival. So they flick through newspapers and what they want to hear is what has Shah Rukh Khan done or Amitabh Bachchan has done or this chap has done or that chap has done. With the result that the newspapers increasingly become infantile. And here I wouldn't even spare a newspaper coming out of, let's say, something like Times of India, where 45% will be little advertisement, large advertisement, with some news thrown in here, and you ask yourself, but these news items have been put in following what pattern? Are you drawing the reader into the paper? No, they are put in because this will be, you know, a woman has been raped here, a girl, somebody has this happened, an old man has fallen there, those kinds of stories. Where do serious issues figure? So for all these reasons, I think the kind of deliberation that takes place in some newspapers in our country, I mean, the Hindu would be a classic example, I can think of one or two other, or which takes place in other countries. I mean, in Britain, I could think of half a dozen newspapers where you'll have serious three or four major articles and three or four major editorials. I think in our country, Indian Express is one exception perhaps, but by and large, newspapers have not been performing the deliberative function that you would expect of it. Let me now turn to the third thing. What have we done with public norms and public morality? Well, here I need to, the less I say, the better it is, because we know what we have done with our public life. Politicians say things which they don't mean. I mean, many of them are ready to offer their loyalty to the highest bidder. But just take two cases. I don't need to retell this sorry tale, but take something very simple. There was a time in our history when the Prime Minister and Senior Minister and Members of Parliament refused to take their salaries on the ground either that they had private incomes or because they wanted to live frugal life. How many people know that Pandit Nehru never took a paisa as a salary during the time that he was the Prime Minister? And I remember when I was a young boy growing up, when he was once asked in Lok Sabha by one of his opponents, "I gather the Prime Minister has not paid his income tax, he must be ashamed of himself." And Panditji was confused. He said, "I'm sorry, I'll check if I have made a mistake." He went back to his office, he asked his secretary, saying, "Is it true that I haven't paid my income tax?" But he said, "Prime Minister, the day you became a Prime Minister, you gave instruction that you didn't want salary, therefore no tax to pay." When Shastriji was there, something similar, and he and his entire family slept on the floor. So we have this. I'm not saying we didn't have this tradition of great public morality, but increasingly, things have moved in a direction. Just take two simple examples. We had the recent story of General V.K. Singh. Poor chap, didn't get what he wanted, his birth date, whatever. And out of sheer pique and anger, he disclosed some of the vital national secrets. When he said that government of India had been funding privately several ministries in the state of Jammu and Kashmir and had also been secretly funding NGOs. Irreparable damage to India's national interest and also to the growth of democracy in India. It never occurred to him that he shouldn't have done this kind of thing. If you are a general of an army, you have to do lots of things which are secret, and just because on one occasion the government does something which should personally to you, you don't get your way, you break all vows and pledges of loyalty. Or you can see what happens to our members of parliament when Supreme Court say criminals should not be allowed, and these guys merrily pass the resolution saying Supreme Court judgment wouldn't bind us. So I think the way in which public morality has collapsed, I don't need to say more about it. And turning now to the last point, has democracy achieved what it was supposed to achieve in terms of well-being of our people? The answer is very mixed. There have been some anti-poverty or poverty alleviation programs, which is something to be proud of. But if you look at the overall economic result of our democracy, officially, between one-third and two-thirds of our people live below the poverty line. When the government passed the food security bill, 72% of the people are entitled to government subsidy on food security, which is to imply that after 65 years of independence, 71% of our people are struggling for survival. Talk about the inequalities constantly growing, a small class at the top making enormous amount of money, and the poor. And increasingly one begins to see two Indias with very little in common between them. And I have been worried about this, I have written about this. what is the future of a country which increasingly fragments into two Indias with nothing in common? Can democracy survive when two groups have nothing in common? So inequality has increased. But it's not just that inequality has increased. It has also increased in United Kingdom, increased in the United States. But with one important difference, that when inequality increases in those countries, there is also some provision for the poor which is guaranteed. And it is also the case that when inequality increases, there is a constant protest against it, and there is an attempt to build up the capital of the poor. This hasn't happened. Equally importantly, when there is this inequality and there are economic inequality and there are rich people, they enjoy their wealth, they go on cruises and all that. But in India, something else happens. Wealth becomes a form of status, something to show off. And wealth is constantly flaunted. In English, what is called in-your-face kind of thing. So that Sharad Pawar on his birthday can have cake as high as the number of years, or Amitabh Bachchan, and you see yourself, is there any moral sensibility left in these people? That there is a limit to how you do these things, and if you do it quietly, why does it have to be flaunted? There is a, somewhere along the line, there is a serious loss of moral sensibility. And you can see that in the language, that even when we talk about programs for the poor, it is as if these poor people are beggars whom the state is trying to help out. Look at the language. We will give you water, says the government, or those who are trying to replace them. We will give you electricity. Just analyze that sentence. Who is this we? There is a state, it has resources. We the people own the state. These are our rights. You have to, it is your duty to do this. Instead, what do you find? Four different assumptions. Behind, we will give you this, which means the state belongs to us, the political class, not you. We will decide how to use its resources, not you. And out of our goodness of our heart, because we are a kind people, we will give you water, we'll give you electricity. And please remember, be grateful and vote for us. Is this any different? I'm asking you to let me know. Any difference between how we treat a beggar? We are turning the poor into glorified beggars. We distribute saris. You distribute in Tamil Nadu, I don't know whether to laugh or cry. In Tamil Nadu, you distribute fish. You distribute chicken. The sort of thing that I would give away to a beggar, the chief minister decides that she is going to give away fish or chicken or this or that. Clothes, sorry. Who are these people? Beggars that you are going to give them? This is their right. Their right to a decent living, right to a decent income. Not to these wretched rags that you throw at them. So even our and I say this with some passion, and I have written about this, even our anti-poverty programs have institutional humiliation built into them. As a culture, as a people, we haven't learned to be ashamed, to be outraged by poverty. At best, poverty is an embarrassment, because foreigners keep telling us. Deep within, we don't feel so outraged that we ought to be doing something about it. So in short, the picture in my view is rather mixed. And if I was marking Indian democracy, I would say about 50, 55 out of 100. So much could have been different, and it's not. How do we explain this? Well, I don't want to go on too long, but I would say very quickly, there are four or five important factors that have played a part. But the structure of the state that the British had created, we continued, even now. So that the policeman, instead of being seen as a servant, is seen as a kind of powerful figure of whom people are frightened. That's the first mistake I think we made. The second is the state has largely been controlled by middle classes. Although poor vote in large numbers, unlike other countries, state has been captured by, the state has been run by the middle classes and therefore has been sympathetic to middle classes. The third thing is, I think we haven't drawn the state-government distinction, which is absolutely crucial. We have made three confusions. State is impartial, stands above society. So institutions of the state, civil service, the police, the army, the armed forces, the judges, these are independent of the government. The government is not allowed to interfere with them. Instead, what happens is the government can use the IB or CBI or Central Vigilance Committee as it pleases to harass its opponents or to get certain things done. So the state doesn't enjoy transcendence, doesn't enjoy impartiality from government, and in turn the government is simply seen as an instrument of whichever party happens to be in power. So state gets reduced to government, which gets reduced to party. And that means that the national interest gets neglected along the line. And I think the last thing that has gone wrong is that somehow we haven't thrown up a political party of the left, which is not the communists, socialists and others, which is able to rise above caste and other considerations and articulate the interest and demands of the poor. So I think things have, in my view at least, things have been rather depressing, and these are some of the factors. But things have gone wrong. I think there are signs of hope, and I want to end by pointing to some areas where I think things have gone reasonably right and they have given us some hope and kept things in a reasonably good shape. First, I think Supreme Court has played a very important part. On many important issues, the Supreme Court has intervened on behalf of the poor, for example, or under trials in Bihar, or for ecological issues. Supreme Court, which was once very conservative, so that Pandit Nehru and others had condemned it and got the constitution changed, has increasingly been behaving in an extremely responsible and interventionist manner. I think the second thing that has helped us is a strong tradition of protest. That's the Gandhian heritage. Well, whatever happens, we are not prepared to lie down and take things for granted. We'll say, we protest. The Satyagraha could have taken more robust forms, but nevertheless, in one form or another, protest tradition has gone on. The third thing I think that's quite promising is that thanks to the efforts of professional classes and civic activists, we have had strategic bits of legislation like right to information or right to education, which have allowed us to prize open the system. The federal structure has been helpful, because although the central government can be rotten, or some states can be bad, other states are making experiments. So that, for example, if the primary or secondary education in Gujarat is extremely poor by international standards, at least in Tamil Nadu, things are different in primary school. Or if midday meal in Bihar is a disaster, if you look at midday meal in Kerala, the situation is different. So there are different experiments taking place in different parts of the country, and that have resulted in certain new policies which other states then can adopt. And I think the economic growth during the last 8 or 9 years has also been helpful, because it has given us breathing space. It has given us enough resources with which to deal with problems of poverty and others. And it has lifted some sections of the poor above the poverty line and given them hope and confidence that they can change things. So these are signs of hope. But these signs don't really amount to a significant radical movement. So if I were to say, do I see out of this mess, do I see a powerful radical movement springing up in the country which can turn the corner or regenerate our democracy? I don't seem to see any. Now here you might say, what happened in Delhi? What about this Aam Aadmi Party? Doesn't it offer us hope? And I want to end by saying, making a few general remarks about what the Aam Aadmi Party has done. I think the first thing it has done, enormous advantages, because it has brought about the psychological breakthrough. It has awakened people to the fact that it is possible to change things. And that can be changed easily, simply by voting in an election. This is how it happened. All you need to do is to go and vote in an election, throw out people, and also that it is open for people to organize in such a way that new candidates can be put up. So the Aam Aadmi Party has given a hope, an opportunity, and created something what Obama once said, yes, we can. And what the party has done is... Well, that's because the things are getting so depressing. So the answer is, yes, we can. And that's great. It has also given us some indication of how things can be different. So I welcome all this, salute all this, and see in it some hope. But I'm not prepared to be excited like a child and think that it has given us the answer. First of all, it is barely 2 months old. Delhi is not India. The experiment succeeded in Delhi, A, because it has a history of Anna Hazare movement preceding the election. There are no caste blocks. Delhi has no scheduled tribes. It has no scheduled castes. It is a metropolis. For all these reasons, an experiment that works there may not work in tribal areas or in those states where we have large chunks of SC, ST and other people, or in UP and Bihar where caste consciousness is extremely deep and people are guided by caste considerations. So I wouldn't say that this can be generalized. I think there is also the other problem with Aam Aadmi movement. While welcome it, we also, I think, need to realize that that movement is still struggling to find its feet. It's all right to talk about supplying water. Still, we talk about giving water, giving electricity to people. And you know, this is not the language I favor. We still talk about doing all this. But then when you go a little further and say, what about your larger vision of the capitalist economy? What about the structure of the state? Party talks in terms of meeting the basic needs of the people, but basic needs is only one step. Beyond that lies inequality. Beyond that lies the quality of deliberation. Beyond that lies this whole area of elections. These have still got to be addressed. And I think going a little further, we also have this whole question of making hard choices. If you are going to give water or electricity, you'll have to find money. Where is the money going to come from? Raising the tax of the middle classes? Well, the middle classes won't like it. Raise productivity, but you don't have much industry there. And for raising productivity, hard decisions have to be made. So the question is, it is all right to talk about this or that. But once you move to the state level and the national level, hard choices, difficult decisions, painful strategies have to be developed. And it is there that interests will begin to clash. You can't satisfy all groups and your honeymoon is over. So at the end of the day, from this humanitarian ideas of leading saintly life and providing basic needs is a welcome first step, but no more than first step. Other steps have to be taken. We will have to design a radical alternative and a radical political organization. And what form it will take, I do not know. Just as we could not have predicted Aam Aadmi until 2 months ago, I am not going to predict whether this new radical movement for regenerating Indian democracy would arise, and if so, where and how. But let us hope that it does, because if it doesn't, this rot will eventually undermine the integrity of this country. Thank you very much.
Anyone from the audience with any questions? Hello. In India, generally the politics is considered as part-time occupation, right? It has the main aim of serving of a nation. You can be an industrialist, but you can be a politician. So there arises a conflict of interest when a decision regarding policy making of my industry is to be taken. So why can't we think politics as a full-time career? Why can't you pursue this politics as a full-time career? Just as we have full-time, let us say, educationalist, we can have full-time industrialist. Why can't we have full-time politician whose main occupation is politics? They will be rewarded properly. Let us say I am graduated from IIM or other prominent institute. I would have got 20 lakhs of package as my remuneration. The politics should give the equal thing, and youth should join politics. You should perform. If you perform, you will be get elected. Otherwise, you will be hired and fired. Why can't we have this perspective in politics?
Politics in our country is individual-centric. Or a person-centric. Since the days of Pandit Nehru, after the death of Sardar Vallabhbhai, there is no collective leadership as such. How do you evaluate it, and what should be done?
Good evening, sir. So, since last 5 years or so, since the last elections, we are seeing an overhaul of social media. We're seeing a medium through which Barack Obama won the elections back in 2008, and there is someone who wants to do the same here in 2014. We have a medium through which vitriolic set of attacks can be done, which is partially unregulated, and where you can spread a message, a propaganda, without showing your identity, your true identity. So how do you see the same affecting the roots of Indian democracy in the current scenario?
Okay. Good evening. My question is, many states in India are having strong regional party, and it seems that next government, central government, might be coalition government. Do you think coalition government will not have courage to take strong and proper decisions at the center to make India a very strong country?
Can you hear me? Well, if you can't hear me, you won't be able to answer the question, will you? Now, I have had 4 questions so far. Let me deal with them in the order in which they were asked. Hiring and firing about politicians. That's what I thought. like Indian democracy. It promises more than it can deliver. Can you hear me? The first question was about the quality of politicians. About the quality of politicians and whether one could improve them in the same way that you can improve in a management school or a management institute by hiring and firing people. Well, that we do anyway. I mean, election is one occasion when you hire and fire, except that we don't hire them. I mean, these guys hire us, if you look at the way in which elections happen. And the other important thing is, again, we don't have the time to look into this, the significance of election in Indian democracy seems to me to be very different from the significance of election in England, where I live. You see, here election has largely become an occasion to punish people. So it's a punitive exercise. It's a day of judgment when God or Allah or Chitragupta or whatever will decide what your future is going to be. It's not an occasion to create something. In England, it's the opposite happens. That election is an occasion when you will articulate a vision and put your people in power so that they can shape the country in a certain way. So our election has become a firing occasion rather than hiring one. It's primarily a judgment on people who have been in power rather than a judgment on people whom you are likely to put. Now with that kind of situation, ask yourself, how do you change the culture of election? And how do you get right kind of people into politics? And more importantly, what is the right kind of people in politics? Now, once again, I could have given example from the Western countries, but one would like to see people in politics who meet certain standards, who are articulate, who are able to master the brief. They can't be experts, but they are people with good judgment and so on. And that you find out by looking at their track record. Now, if you don't have people with track record standing for parliament, then you have no means to make judgment on them. And that, I think, is partly of a tragedy. Not that good people are not going into politics, because I don't know what is good. A good person by himself is not enough. Because good means what? He's clean. But his cleanliness, innocence is not enough. Does he have the brain? Does he have the capacity for making judgment? Does he have the capacity to master his brief? So I think the pool from which we draw our politician is far more important than simply hiring and firing them. A university professor, a manager in an institute, I mean, there it's all right. But in politics, it's a very different kind of game. And very different qualities of leadership are required. So that will be my short answer to your question. Second was, we are individual-centered, we don't have collective leadership. I think you are absolutely right. But one needs to be careful in two ways. You see, it goes back to the days of Mahatma Gandhi. I mean, he dominated Congress. And when he sometimes didn't get his way, he will go on fast. Or he will resign from Congress, but continue to control this from outside. I mean, the old man had his own peculiar way of handling things, liberal but also authoritarian. But it's very striking that he also encouraged collective leadership. And to my mind, he is the greatest Indian in our history, partly because he was able to raise a large number of ordinary individuals into great leaders. And more importantly, although they all had their egos, he was able to handle them so beautifully that whether it was Pandit Nehru or Vallabhbhai Patel or Kriplani or Rajendra Prasad or whoever, they all were kept together. Including his last days, when Vallabhbhai Patel could easily have resigned from the government. And there is a beautiful account in Manu Ben's diary, which had not yet been published, but I was looking at it the other day, when in that diary Manu Ben says that Mani Ben Patel, Vallabhai's daughter, went to see Bapuji. And Manu Ben writes in the diary, she spent 1.5 hours attacking Pandit Jawaharlal, criticizing him because he was not being fair to Vallabhai, her father. And Manu Ben writes in the diary, I was angry with Bapuji because Bapuji kept listening and he should have stopped her. So this kind of tension was going on. But still, the last picture that we have of Gandhiji was Panditji to the right, Jawaharlal to the left, and Gandhiji whispering something into their ear and keeping them together. So here is a man who was an individual in his own right, but at the same time was a remarkable handler of men. And it wasn't easy for him. And it is also, I think, remarkable. The Indians are rather puritanical, don't like to talk about it. Nearly 75 to 80% of the leaders close to Gandhiji were having all kinds of extramarital affairs, and Gandhiji knew them all. I mean, Jawaharlalji's affairs he knew well. I mean, he knew, I shouldn't go through all this now with young people, but all of them were having wonderful life, and Gandhiji would know that, smile, inquire about their girlfriends. They loved it, they trusted him, and the old man was able to handle them beautifully. And that has been the great strength of our old generation. I met such old men in Baroda when I was a young student, Rajibhai Patel, Mota. I mean, he encouraged many of us, knew the little silly things we used to do. I couldn't smoke in the presence of my father, but smoke in his presence, tell certain silly things that I have done. I think Gandhi had that skill. He was a good judge of people. Remarkably good judge. In fact, when Panditji first went to see him, Gandhiji sized him up, and then quietly afterwards he told Mahadevbhai, the loneliest man I have ever seen. Make him a professor of media studies. He knew that. He had something similar about Subhash. So I think there is a tradition of collective leadership. That declines. That declines during the time of Pandit Nehru. And you had people like C.D. Deshmukh. I think you are all too young to remember. But C.D. Deshmukh, not you ma'am, but I think you are the other people. C.D. Deshmukh resigning from the cabinet saying, look, even when Panditji had refused to give Bombay to Maharashtra, he said he did it on his own and he wouldn't consult anybody. Becomes worse with Indira Gandhi. Becomes worse. Collective leadership emerges with Manmohan Singh, but there is neither collective nor leadership. Everyone going their own way. And then if you look at the state level, it gets hilarious. Vijay Lalita, her cabinet knows, she decides the policy for the entire government, and her ministers hear about it when her secretary rings them up and says, this is your policy. I wouldn't say about the chief minister here, but if you look at Patnaik in Orissa, he can't even verbally communicate with his ministers because he hasn't bothered to learn Oriya. He just sends instructions. So I think collective leadership in our country has become increasingly difficult, partly because the leader is politically insecure. He can't trust anybody. And therefore he is not prepared to encourage other leaders. And also because the great importance of caste, so that the man would trust only people of his own caste and not outsider. So it's a very complex issue. If you take a social media, I mean, social media play a very important role. Let me just finish this. Social media, of course, play a very important role. You communicate. I mean, lots of, whether it is Anna Hazare movement or lots of others, simply wouldn't have taken place without the impact of social media. And on the question, I think, what was the last question? No, there was another one. I noticed it and I can't read my own writing because I wrote it hurriedly. Who asked the last question and what was it? Oh, the strong government. I'm sorry. Sorry.
Coalition government at the center level.
Well, two things. First of all, I'm slightly uneasy about the idea of strong government. I don't know what it means. Or strong leaders. Leaders are there to formulate policies and to see them implemented. Strong and weak wouldn't make any sense. Government business is to govern and it must know how. The question is, what coalition does is something, it can be interesting. We have coalition in Great Britain. Coalition between Liberal Democrats and Conservative Party. And we have had coalitions in the past. And I remember, since I sit on Manmohan Singh's advisory committee, and over lunch once, when I was sitting next to him, he said, Professor Saab, tell me, how does coalition function in Great Britain? And I said, you know, if you look at the way in which two political parties in Britain, Conservatives and Liberal, the Dems, decided to enter into a coalition, negotiations went on for 6 days on every item of importance to them. And they reached what you might call common program, common policy. They also decided that neither partner in the coalition should be able to get out when they want to. So they said this coalition will last, come what may, for 5 years. No, not one day more, not one day less. Therefore, our election date for the first time in our history is fixed. Now, I would have liked coalition here to take that kind of form. If it is a government, it's a single government, you don't have multi-party government, and therefore coalition partners should be able to agree on certain minimum program which they are going to implement, and they must make sure that none of them is allowed to defect or get out of the government before a certain period of time. Agreed agenda and an agreed calendar. Once that happens, things can be different because we are condemned to have coalition in one form or another. We can't escape it. What I think coalition, it has the potential for achieving something great, but it also has a potential for doing a lot of harm to the country. It can do a lot of harm because coalition would mean not between two national parties, but one, usually it is one national party and two or three or four regional parties. Although my friend Lord Meghnad Desai has been recommending a coalition between Congress and BJP, which is possible. Which is possible. It can happen. In fact, I can predict that by a certain date something like this will happen. If you see too many coalition parties, small parties, and if you look at the corporate houses in this country, most of them strongly favor a coalition between Congress and BJP. With a guarantee an economic policy which will continue, no fluctuations, stability, they can go ahead with planning. So the business class in India would prefer a coalition between two national parties as opposed to the coalition we had, which is one national party with half a dozen little ones joining them. Now, since we like it or not, for the next few years, one big national party and some regional parties, two things happen. The national party constantly benefits from the contribution made by the regional parties. It becomes richer. And in a country like India, you can't have a single uniform perspective. Other parts of the India should be able to make their contribution. So it can lead to a richer national perspective. That's the potential for good. But this potential for harm is that if the national party is not clear about what it wants or is too weak, then the regional party can, like a tail wagging the dog, the regional party can bring down the national party and increasingly regionalize the very idea of national interest. And my fear is that if we are not careful, next election might do that, which is several regional parties coming together, no prominent, dominant national party, and the so-called national interest simply becomes a collection of regional interest. That's the danger.
Good evening, sir. My name is Kanan Dhruv. You know, when I first saw the topic, an Indian ailing polity, I thought, I thought perhaps, you know, there are a lot of good things about the Indian polity that are going on and we give little credit to. But then I was particularly concerned when you talked about the failing public morality and the declining standards. But we are part of the solution generation. You know, we seek solutions and we seek to create an India which is positive and which is thriving. What solutions do you see as far as, you know, making Indian public morality also equal to the Western public morality, for instance? Thank you.
Hello, sir. So my question is also regarding public morality, and I was wondering if there are different public moralities within India. So is there a disconnect between the public morality that prevails in perhaps the ruling class and the rest of us? Also, is there a disconnect between the institutions and the public morality, thereby creating some kind of a culture of hypocrisy? So even the most corrupt person in theory does not want to be corrupt. Is it possible to change the institutions in this light, given the barriers of the constitution? And you mentioned a radical alternative. Even if you can't tell us what that radical alternative might be, could you give us some more idea about what changes do you see in the coming years to save the problems that exist today?
Can you hear me? Yeah. Well, both the questions, you seem to have conspired together to ask the same thing. And that's a very moral action to do. In your own different ways, you raise the question about public morality. And that interests me a great deal. In fact, 2 days ago, I was giving a keynote address on public morality in India at Jawaharlal Nehru University. And I've been giving a lot of thought to public morality in other parts of the world and in our own. If you look at our independence struggle, the moral standards were of the highest order, whether it was the Mahatma or Panditji or Vallabhai or whatever. The public morality was incredibly high. By public morality, I mean not morality of the public, but the morality of those who occupy public positions and how they conduct their affairs with each other in public. Now, remember when Vallabhai was his home minister, some people thought they can please him by sending a little circular that Maniben Patel should be drafted into the Congress Executive Committee, High Command. When Vallabhai got to know about it, he called the petition organizers and said, "Stop this nonsense, and if I hear you do it again, I will deal very harshly with you." Now, that's a man of his stature at his highest. Gandhiji never promoted anybody, none of his sons or daughters. And one can think of lots of other examples, Shastriji one. So it's not that we have been devoid of public morality altogether. But it is also striking, and this is what puzzles me, they complained about the lack of public morality that we hear now were first heard in 1937, when provincial governments under the Government of India Act 1935 were elected. If you look at Gandhiji's magazine, journal, where he used to write regularly, constant complaints by readers and Gandhiji himself about total absence of morality in the ministers and in civil servants. So it somehow seems to be part of our cultural genes. Or if you look at Pandit Nehru's administration, I think in 1953, I saw the figure somewhere, 54,000 civil servants of one kind or another were charged with violations of basic norms. But then Panditji acted as swiftly as he could. But things, in other words, are not new. What is new is the scale and the depth to which people are prepared to fall. So let's not get it completely out of perspective. What do we do about it? It's a long story. very quickly, because I have a 6-point program, but this is not the time to outline it. At one level, we need a profound cultural change. I think one of the things which happens is this. In our kind of society, where people have deep family and caste loyalties, so they feel that they have certain deep obligations to their own family and to the caste. When they get into positions of public power, they ask themselves, should I forget my caste obligations? No, I can't, because I have obligations to my children, I have obligations to my caste. So there is a genuine moral dilemma they think they face. And that leads to immorality so far as public life is concerned, but seems perfectly moral so far as their caste loyalty is concerned. That's one point. And even, I don't know if you know, a great figure of my days called Chakravarti Rajgopalachari or Rajaji. He once wrote a wonderful article where he says, if I belong to a particular caste, I have inherited certain obligations, and when I occupy a public position, should I forget those obligations? And he had a lovely phrase. He said, to call that nepotism in the name of some Western notion of administrative purity is wrong. Now, this is Rajaji. Lalu Prasad Yadav will have no difficulty justifying what is wrong. So the first thing is to get people to recognize that public life has its own norms. A public official can help his caste in other ways, but not by misusing his public office. So the notion of the public has to emerge before the notion of public morality has to emerge. And then, of course, you must have incentives and sanctions. How do things happen in other countries? Britain was just as corrupt as we are in the 19th century. United States, in some respects, is even more corrupt than we are, even now. Business, corporate houses, I mean, the lobbying that goes on, the way they buy Congress legislators, I saw all that when I was a professor there. But what you have are sanctions. The law is applied vigorously, and if you can lock up 20 of your ministers for violating public norms, you have set a powerful example to a lot of others. It has to be punitive. That's one important thing. And I think the other important thing is social stigma. You see, in England, for example, and this is one difference I noticed, if a minister has been to jail or has misbehaved and has been attacked, his friends, his family, others will tend to look down upon him. There is a stigma associated with it. He will be ignored, ostracized. Here, nothing happens. The man walks out and he's back in parliament, or in his social circle, he enjoys the same degree of reputation. In other words, there is no shame associated with being accused of lack of public morality. So one would start thinking of law, social pressure, and a deeper level changing the culture, and at the end of the day, creating a kind of environment in which people wouldn't think of doing certain things. I mean, think of the university. There may be a small percentage of professors who can cheat or who can bribe, who can accept money and get somebody a first class or whatever happens. But the number is very small. Temptation is just as large, but the number is small and declining. How did that happen? How did our academic morality improve? I think we can learn some lessons from that.
Question relates to the accountability of the elected politicians. You mentioned about the record of legislation which the elected representatives have passed in various states. We also have seen what has happened in the parliament also in the last several sessions. Apart from legislative accountability, there is also accountability for the various government actions and so on. So there is a very dismal record of accountability of elected politicians. When they go for election, the picture is different. They stand for certain things, and all that is forgotten, all that is put aside. How do we ensure that these politicians who get elected on the basis of certain responsibilities, duties and obligations and promises remain accountable during the period between elections? That, I think, is one of the things. And I was happy when you said, and I share that with you, about the Aam Aadmi Party, that yes, they have started well, they have acted fast, they have tried to implement what they had promised, thereby shown a certain degree of accountability. These are early days. The jury is still out, but I think there is some hope there. So how do we ensure that this accountability of the politicians is ensured in the intervening period?
Can you hear me at the back? Now, Praful Bhai's question, I think, goes to the heart of parliamentary democracy, which is you elect your representatives, and until the next election, Now, Praful Bhai's question, in case some of you didn't follow, I think it goes to the heart of parliamentary democracy or representative democracy, which is you elect your representatives on the basis of certain claims they have made and certain expectations. They will come to you after 5 years or 4 years for re-election. You can throw them out. What's the use? For during 4 years, they would have done a lot of mischief. They would have done something they said they will never do, or they have not done what they said they would do. What do you do to increase their accountability? Now that's, I think, is an absolutely important question. I have been worried about it very deeply. Of course, in a British context, where also this happens, but certainly in our context, where a politician gets elected on one set of policies, and after into power, but no power, but after elections, when he finds that his fortunes are better served by another party, he sells his loyalty to a party which follows his opposite policies. What do you do? Now, we have one law, defection. Now, I remember talking to Ansari Ji, our vice president, once. And he was telling me that this anti-defection law has done more harm than good. And I asked him, I said, Ansari Ji, ye bataiye, agar kuch changes lana ho to kya karenge? He said, this law should go. Why? Because anti-defection means that any political party might decide that you, because you disagree with the party, are defecting and therefore throw you out. And it has increased the enormous power of the leader of a political party and decreased the power of an ordinary MP. So in India, any good thing that we implement turns out to be poisonous. So the anti-defection wouldn't help. What else? Two things. Now, I have no answer. If I had, I would have patented them long time ago. But I would, after a lot of reflection, I have come to two conclusions. First, I think if an MP were to change his policies, then not his political party, it is not defection. It's a defection itself implies that he is moving away from his party. I would look upon as a fraudulent act. Just as you can perpetrate fraud on the constitution, a law, as the Supreme Court would say, you can perpetrate fraud on your constituents or on your voters. And on that ground, on criminal or civil ground, breaking a promise, you should be able to prosecute him. And since that takes a long time, this parliamentary prosecution should be done quickly by the speaker, representation made to the speaker, or a waiting committee of the Lok Sabha or Raj Sabha and giving a decision. That would be one way. In other words, and I told Ansari ji that if I was advising the Prime Minister of India, which happily I am not, I would formulate it differently. Not defection, but betrayal of trust. That would be one. The other thing is to institutionalize a series of regular consultation. So that in Britain, for example, I keep mentioning Britain, because not because it's an example, it's an ideal, it has its own limitations, but I understand it better, and we got our system from there. You have something called regular surgeries. Regular surgery. Surgery simply means that every week on a Saturday, an MP's office is open from 9 in the morning till 3 in the afternoon, where any member of the constituency can drop in for any complaint to be handled, or a group of constituents to pursue this or that matter. I think that kind of thing should be made compulsory. Because although I live in Baroda, I'm a member of British Parliament, if I want to see the local MP, it's difficult to track him down. It must be a requirement that an MP must every week be available to his constituents. Some such institutionalized consultation, I think, is absolutely important. These two I would insist on. Beyond that, one more a matter of wish, preaching, rather than effective sanctions. I have, yes, no, I know. Yeah, no, I thought you might mention this, and I was going to comment on this. I think right to recall is important, something to be said for it, but my feeling is that in our kind of democracy, it might backfire. Because in order the right to recall, you will have to say, let's say 10% of the voters must ask. Now you can easily mobilize 10%. So that no MP will be able to take an independent stand. He would constantly be looking over his shoulder to see if they are going to recall him. You may introduce the right of recall, but I think there must be two conditions on it. One, only once. If he is in power, if he is elected for 4 years, you can't keep recalling every month or every 2 months or every 6 months. You must say only right to recall only once. And secondly, the bar will have to be raised so that rather than 10% of the electorate, it will have to be something like 25%. That might work